I grieve my Lord from day to day. I sort his love so full and free. And though I wandered far away, my mother's prayers have followed me. I'm coming home, I'm coming home to live my wasted life on you. For mother's prayers have followed me, have followed me the whole world through. O'er desert wild, o'er mountain high, the wanderer I've sworn to be. A wretched soul condemned to die, still mother's prayers have followed me. I'm coming home, I'm coming home, to live my wasted life on you. For mother's prayers have followed me, have followed me the whole world. He turned my darkness into light, this blessed Christ of Calvary. I'll praise his name both day and night, that mother's prayers have followed me. I'm coming home, I'm coming home to live my wasted life on you. For mother's prayers have followed me, have followed me the whole world through. So
for the next 2 weeks, we'll be taking a little bit of a break from our series on Job, this week for Mother's Day and next week for Mission Awareness Sunday. Now, one might argue that Job is still appropriate, that mothers are particularly long-suffering. After all, I recently watched a video that including screaming kids that could be heard in the background as the mother sunk to the floor saying, "Mummy needs a quarantine." As much as his children can be deeply loved, being with them 24/7 for over a month may have left some mothers feeling that it's been the longest month ever. So there could be some link to suffering. But I somehow don't think a reflection on the sufferings of Job is really where I want to take this day. So I'm going to begin by saying Happy Mother's Day to those mothers who may be watching, and I'll invite you to join with me in our call to worship that will be printed on that will appear up on the screen. And Jenny's going to read our responses parts for us. So let us join together. From you, Lord, every family on earth receives a share of love.
Illuminate our homes
with the light of your love.
Today we thank you for the gifts of love we have received.
From our mothers, those who have served as mothers in many ways,
nourishing and guiding us as we grow.
As we have been loved by them,
so we are loved by you, Lord.
Let us join in celebration this morning
as we rejoice in being loved.
And so let us come before God today with our prayers of approach. Join with me. Lord God, with a mother's heart, you gather your children. You comfort and hold us in your warm embrace. When we hurt, your arms enfold us. When we are afraid, your wings protect us. When we are hungry, you feed us with the bread of life. God, with a mother's heart, your love surrounds and supports us in good times and bad, in the midst of joy and pain, always and everywhere. You will never leave or abandon us. God with a mother's heart, you forgive our foibles and follies. We confess that like a rebellious child, too often we have ignored your advice at our own peril. Our words, they aren't always as nice as you would wish them. Our tantrums when we don't get our way at times can put a two-year-old to shame. Our sin, it strains our relationship with you. And yet with a mother's heart, you reach out to us. And so we come back to you with thankful, grateful hearts for this day, for being part of your family, coming before you as you taught us. We join together to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Paul, in his letter to the Romans, reminds us, You did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. We cry, Abba, Father. And it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And so we rejoice that we are people welcomed into the family of God. Our opening hymn today is Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. And I'll get those words up onto our screen.
Suddenly return, but never, never.
Thank you, Glenn. And Jenny has again prepared a children's story for us this week, so I'm going to turn it over to Jennifer Pollard, and she will also have something to share with us.
Good morning, everyone. So our children's story today is going to be the start of our journey with Moses. Moses was... And the story of Moses starts in the book of Exodus, with the story about him as a baby and his mother. So Moses was an Israelite. He was born in Egypt at a time when the Egyptians were very angry with the Israelites. The Egyptians were so angry that they enslaved all of the Israelites. And when the Israelites kept having growing families, they demanded all the baby boys be thrown into the Nile River. But Moses' mother was a brave woman, and she loved her baby son so much that she kept him hidden from the Egyptians. Soon, though, the baby grew too big to hide, and his mother knew that she would have to come up with a different plan to save his life. So she took a woven basket, and after wrapping the baby in a blanket, she put him in the basket and laid it in the reeds of the river. The basket floated away, and Miriam, Moses' sister, watched it to make sure that he was safe inside. The little basket traveled down the river and eventually came to rest near Pharaoh's palace. Pharaoh was the king of Egypt. His daughter, a princess, came to the river that day and found the basket. At first, Miriam was afraid that the princess would throw her brother into the river because he was an Israelite. But the princess felt sorry for the little baby. She took him from the basket and decided to look after him like he was her own son. And she was the one who named him Moses. So Moses' story starts with two mothers. One who loved her son so much that she gave him up so he would be protected. And another who understood that a baby is innocent and needs love and caring. Without these two mothers, Moses' story would be very different. Today, as we all know, is Mother's Day, and if we were at church together, we would be bringing flowers to all of the mothers in our congregations. And then we will be going to Sunday school to make something special for them. So today I wanted to share with you a card that you can make at home for your own mom. So you'll need three sheets of construction paper, three different colors. One should be your favorite color, one should be your mom's favorite color, and the third should be a completely different color. You're also going to need scissors and markers and a little bit of scotch tape. So cut the paper that's your mom's favorite color into quarters, so you end up with a little piece that looks kind of like this. My mom's favorite color is yellow, so I went with yellow. You take one quarter and you fold it in half, like this. And then you're gonna take a pair of scissors and you're gonna cut through the folds. I've already pre-cut this one, but you cut through the folds, but not all the way through to the edge. So when you open it up, after you've made six or seven cuts, what you're gonna have is a piece of paper that looks like this. You'll be able to open it up a little bit, okay? But it's still gonna have solid edges all the way around. Then you're gonna take the piece of paper that's your favorite color, and you're gonna cut it into quarters again, and then you're gonna cut one quarter into little strips like this, okay? So you'll probably end up with probably 9 or 10. You're gonna have some left over at the end, but that's okay. You're gonna take the strips of your paper and you're gonna weave it in and out of the quarter that you cut that's your mom's favorite color. Just like this. And you're going to keep doing that until you've covered the whole little card that you've made. When it's done, it's going to look like this. Then you're going to take your third piece of paper and you're going to fold it in half to form a card. Draw a heart on the front. I've already drawn it and cut it out. And then carefully cut it out, but make sure you leave the whole edge intact, okay? When you open it up, you'll have a solid piece right here and a front with a hole. Hello. So then you take your what you're weaving. You need to carefully make sure that it fits to cover the whole of the heart opening in your card. So what you'll end up with when you tape it in place is a Mother's Day card with a heart cut out that is contains a woven heart made of your favorite color and your mom's favorite color. So even if you have brothers and sisters who are making the same card, it's going to look different because chances are you don't have the same favorite color. When you finish taping it in, I haven't taped mine because I wanted to have the pieces separate to show you. When you've got it taped together, then you can use your markers to write a message like Happy Mother's Day on the front. I added a little heart and some flowers because my mom loves flowers. And then on the inside, which I haven't done yet either, you can write a little message or a poem for your mom for Mother's Day. The greatest thing that Moses' birth mother did for him was to protect him by putting him in a little woven basket and sending him away to safety. So this Mother's Day, when you've been home with your mom for a pretty long time, remember to thank her for all the things she does every day to keep you safe and happy and healthy. Happy Mother's Day, everyone, and I hope that we are back together in church soon.
Thank you, Jenny. Our first scripture lesson for today is coming from Peter's first letter, reading in chapter 3, verses 13 to 22. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, while the ark was being built. Only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, powers, and submission to him. The second lesson for today is coming from the Gospel according to John, reading in chapter 14, verses 15 to 21. If you love me, Jesus says, keep my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you will also live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. And our own Glenn Chafe has an anthem for us today. We pray for our mothers today, that he's written especially for today. And we've got the words that we can watch, we can see as he plays it.
This is for mothers everywhere, with sincere, heartfelt gratitude.
Thank you, Glenn. A strange quirk about me that may not do much for my macho bad boy kind of image. Of course, she has been laughs a little in the background at my trying to say that I have a bad boy image, which implies that might not exactly be who I am. Well, anyway, a strange quirk I have is that when we've been traveling, I've been known to try and take pictures of wildflowers while we're on vacation. They're often not the most visible ones either, but ones that are just somehow noticed as walking by a woodland path, the little tiniest little wildflowers. They require me to bend down close to catch the beauty of something that would easily be missed even at walking speed. So small and fleeting, that flash of color along the path. It's a minuscule sight compared to the oceanside trail that we're normally on at such times. It's an observation that can equally apply to spiritual things. As humans, we're often attracted to what seems showy or grand. But when we are in a quiet, worshipful state of mind, then we can become more aware of the great beauty and humble things. Some things are best appreciated on our knees, and not just the things of nature, where close examination can reveal God's attention to detail, but also other people like our parents, you know, like our mothers whom we're seeking to honor today. There are times when it's easy to appreciate our mothers, their virtues, their hard work, their care, Their love is often so vivid. We don't necessarily need to get deeply down to notice it. But other times it can be more difficult to appreciate and honor our mothers or any of our parents for that matter. It could come because of a separation or divorce that split one's family, and a child has become quite aware that they are being weaponized in the battle between former spouses. It could come as a child begins to grow up and finds their mother won't really let them grow up. Or it could come when that mother gets older still and stubbornly resists the help that her now aged self clearly requires but won't accept. There's times when we're around other people, we'd rather complain about our mothers. For some, there's another difficulty we can find in this day. It can be simply a reminder that our mother's no longer with us. Old hurts resurfacing each and every Mother's Day. There's many reasons we can end up with mixed feelings about Mother's Day. Such mixed feelings may in fact be the sort of situation that Jesus was addressing when he was speaking to his disciples the night before his death. After a long time together, a time in which he nurtured and fed and taught and loved his disciples fully, he announced that he was leaving them. He would allow himself to be put to death. It was and is a hard thing to grasp, how a person could voluntarily leave those they love. So the disciples, they naturally resisted this idea. They did not want Jesus to leave. They did not want to face a future without his guidance, without his grace always right there around him. In today's reading, Jesus told his disciples that when he left, he would not leave them as orphans, but he would come back to them. And while the rest of the world would not see him anymore, they would see him. That the Spirit of God would abide with him, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of truth and of love. "If you love me," he said, "you will obey what I command, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them." There are some things that really are best appreciated on our knees, and this is one of them: loving and obeying Christ, even when we don't understand what he is up to, even when we're uncertain about what he has become and just where he is located. Even when we don't understand why he felt he had to leave us. At some point it can lead to an understanding, to a feeling of conviction, an inner certainty that we are not actually alone. In some fashion or other, he is with us, and that there is comfort for us. There is some sense of wholeness found in it, a sense that there is a light in the darkness, that everything is okay, and that in fact everything is going to work out well. No matter what happens, no matter what the immediate future may bring to us, it's going to still be okay. As it is with Christ, so it is with one another, and especially with our parents, with those individuals that God commands us to honor. And promised us that as we honor them, if we love them and show them respect, that we will live long and prosper in the land the Lord is giving us. It follows that strange pattern of those first 10 commandments from Moses that works in a promise and blessing when it comes to keeping them. Now, the secret of what honoring is and what it involves is found in that command Jesus gives to his disciples. The command that not only should we love one another, but that we should love them as he loves us. To love others, to love our parents or our brothers or sisters or our neighbors, it can be difficult at times. As you know, it cost Jesus his life. But he gave that love, his life, willingly, because it was what love demanded. In a spiritual sense, love always demands we give up our lives, that we give up ourselves willingly for someone else. To love as Jesus loved, it means quite simply that we will forgive others the pain they cause us, that we will reach to bless those who seem indifferent to us, even hostile towards us, that we will care even when we do not feel cared for, that we will pray for others and seek the best for them even when they seem bound to betray us, as Judas would betray Jesus. Somewhat love someone else as Jesus loves us does not require that we understand them, nor does it require that we approve of their actions or their life or their decisions. And it more certainly doesn't require that they love us, even though it's always very nice when they do. To love someone as Jesus loves us is to obey Christ's command. In that way, begin to discover that we're not alone. It requires us to submit to that the feelings of our hearts may go deeper than at first we think. The attitude of our minds and wisdom and counsel of God have something to teach us. As I've said before, repeat once more, some things are best appreciated on our knees. Following and obeying Christ is key to a life that is worth living. It's the key to never being alone, the key to knowing the comfort of the Spirit's presence, the Spirit that communicates the presence of both Father and Son, the Spirit that leads us to truth, which is that truth that will set us free. You know, the intention of the founder of the day we call Mother's Day was that we set aside a special day to pay particular honor to our mothers, and by doing so, encourage everyone to love their mothers in concrete, tangible ways each and every day. Miss Anna Jarvis, like her mother before, was very concerned about the neglectful treatment of mothers by their adult children, and she felt that she had not done enough for her mother. After a long campaign on May the 10th, 1908, the third anniversary of her mother's death, the first official Mother's Day service was held at St. Andrews Methodist Church in Grafton, West Virginia. The theme of the service was Christian love for mothers and for all women and ultimately for all people. Concrete and tangible love honors our mothers, whether they're with us and us with them in the same home or whether they're in another home or another province or even if they've gone to be with God. Love, concrete, tangible love, be it that love that was communicated by God through Moses for our parents or the love that was commanded by Jesus for one another, it comes to us with a promise. The promise that we will live long and prosper, that we will not be left as orphans, that the God and all that he brings will be with us. For when God is with us, so are the saints above, and so are we surrounded by the saints below as well. On Mother's Day and all the days beyond it, love your mother and your fathers and one another. Because part of loving and honoring your mothers is having a love that overflows to all around you. So we're reminded where there's pain, love. Where there's laughter, love. Where there's hurt, love. Where there's joy, love. Always love and you will not be alone. Angels will speak to you. God will quietly whisper into your ear. And the comfort that you and indeed all of us need will come to you. And you will know that the only truth that matters is the end, is the truth that gives you life and sets you free. Free to be what God intended you to be, even before that day when you were first conceived. So as Moses' command says, honor your father and mother. Love one another, as I have loved you, as Jesus tells us. And I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, you will see me. Because I live, you will also live. Blessed be that God who walks with us day by passing day, now until the end of time. Amen. Our next hymn is Happy the Home When God Is There. And I'm going to bring the words up for us to see. In Matthew, Jesus tells us, freely you have received, freely give. May we continue to be a people who give back. As we support the ministry of this church through our offerings, I thank you for continuing to do so. Links to donate via Canada Helps or e-transfer are available in our video description. The prophet Isaiah tells us, as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. Mothers come in many different forms, and today we celebrate them all, including that mothering nature of our God. And so I'd invite you to join with me in prayer. Mothering God, we draw on the image of you as the one who nurtures and gathers, who protects. We pray for those women who have nurtured us as mothers. Some who are no longer with us, whom we miss dearly. We reflect on those women who have influenced our own lives in so many ways and give you thanks. We pray for the women around the world who are working long days and nights to raise their children right now. We pray for mothers who have fled violence and difficult situations, be they refugees, be they ones who have become separated from their children. Some experience the tragedy and death of a child. We pray for mothers living in the uncertainty, facing the unknown, and needing your support and help. We pray for all the women who are expecting, those not quite yet mothers. Thank God for those soon to be mothers. All the hope and promise welling up inside. And of course, all the fear and worry too, about whether they will be able to do this monumental task. And so they need one like you to walk alongside them, to remind them that they're not doing this alone, that they always have one whom they can lean on. We pray for families where our mother's illness has led to an early death. We pray for those who have stepped in to help with the care and nurture of children, including extended families, remembering those too who have acted as mothers to the motherless, some without even having children of their own. Some more a mother than biology would whatever straight state was possible in tracing a family tree. We give thanks for mothers with hearts so big that their love inspires forever. We pray for those women who have lost a child to death and must carry on. We pray for strength and courage of mothers who have faced grief and loss and who find this to be a day of pain. We pray for women whose children have grown and whom they may now seldom see. We pray especially for families frayed and fractured by the separation required by the times in which we are now living. We pray for mothers who are at a distance from their children, whatever the cause. May the bonds of love never know bounds of distance that's too great, a chasm too large, that the motherly love doesn't cross over. We pray for women who have desperately wanted to have children of their own, but for some reason haven't been able to, or have chosen instead to simply be a mother to everyone else. We thank God for those who have been mothers in spirit. We pray for those who are troubled by the prospect of motherhood, perhaps because it came too soon, or perhaps because they found themselves the too few resources to care for a child. May the village that we say is needed to raise a child truly be found as support and strength for those who need it most. We pray too for adoptive mothers, those whose love grafts a family of outcasts together into one of love and care, in much the same way as you knit together the kingdom of heaven by grafting us into Christ's very family. And so, God, we thank you for your mothering nature. And so we offer you prayers this day. Hear those prayers of our hearts, as we remember those who have been a mother to us, those whose mothering has inspired us, and the God whose example extends to our very definition of family. Amen. Our closing hymn today is Now Thank We All Our God, and I'll have those words appear up for us too.
And keep us.
The prophet Isaiah reminds us, I have cared for you before you were born. Yes, carried you before you were born. Now go in the comfort and peace of the one who made us, the assurance that our comforter is always with us. Go to share love and peace with others. May divine wisdom guide us as we go forth on our paths of peace. May she give us blessings more precious than silver or gold. May we find in sharing these blessings with others that we are indeed people who have been truly blessed by our God. So go in the blessing of God the Father, go covered by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and united in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, who is with you now and forevermore. Amen.
Singing, oh,
sacred scenes unfold. As I travel on life's pathway, know not what the years may hold. As I ponder, precious memories flood my soul. Precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the precious, sacred scenes unfold.
Thank you all.